Hello and welcome back. Today we're going to look at an investment decision rule called equivalent annual annuity. And you actually already seen this when Anders did it in the time value of money. He computed an equivalent annual annuity. But now we're going to apply it on projects. Okay, so we are still in this series where we look at different investment decision rules. And today we're going to look at equivalent annual annuity. So before we start, it could be useful to have a little bit of terminology. So when you have two investments and you cannot choose both. So if you choose one, it means that you cannot do the other. So for example, let's say that I'm going to build a house on the ground I own. Either I build a big house or I build a small house. And if I choose one, I cannot also do the other because then the space is already used. Anyway, if you have two projects or investments which are like this, so you cannot do both, then they're said to be mutually exclusive. So I'm going to use that term later on. Okay, so let's take an example. We have two different investments here. One has cash flows of 50 first year, 70 next year, 80 the third year, and 100 in the fourth and the fifth year. And the second one has 80 every year, and they both cost 300. So if these are mutually exclusive, which one should we choose? Well, they have the same lifespan, and that means that we should use the net present value. We simply compute the net present value of both, and we take the one with the higher NPV. That's what we did earlier. Okay, so here in this case, I've done it. The NPV for investment B is much higher than for investment A, which means that we should choose investment B of these two. Okay, but what happens if it looks like this instead? Well, now it might still be so that B is more profitable in or have a higher NPV, but as you see here, after the fifth year, the investment B still goes on and investment A doesn't. So the question then comes, what are we going to do in this later period? So what happens here? Because then we already got all the money from A, so maybe we can reinvest it at something else with a positive NPV. And how can we then say whether or not B is better than A? We need something else. So in this case, it turns out that B has a slightly higher NPV, but as I said, they have different lifespans, so it's not so easy to distinguish which one is actually better just by looking at the NPV. And then it would be very nice, let's say that they can be reinvested, so we can do the same investment over and over again. And that would mean that for investment A, we could again do this here, so we get the same cash flows again. And then it would be very nice if we had a way to convert this present value or the net present value into like an annual cash flow. So we would like to convert this to cash flows in the future, once per year for the entire life of the investment, which corresponds to this NPV. But in fact, you already done that. You did that in the in one of the videos of time value of money with Anders. So just to remember, we always consider net cash flows and we want it to be on comparable terms. So in this case, comparable could mean that we have an annual net cash flow instead of this NPV. So if we can change this so it's something positive every year, then these two can be compared. Okay, so remember one of the disadvantages with NPV. When we compare mutually exclusive investments that have unequal lifespans and they can be replaced by a positive NPV investment at the end of the investment, then just NPV is not enough to say which one is better. But we're going to make it slightly simpler than just say that it's some positive. We're going to look at investments that can be repeated. So we repeat the exact same investment or at least at the exact same terms. So then we can simply add them onto each other after the end of the investment. And then again, NPV is not enough to say which one is better, but we can compute the equivalent annual annuity, which we already know how to do. And we do it like this. So we take the NPV and then we divide it by this big sum here. Or not a sum, but it is a big factor. Then we get what is called an equivalent annual annuity. But I want to stress, it's very important that you remember to have parentheses on the sides here. If you don't, it might be wrong when you hit it into your calculator or your computer. Okay, so what happens then if we do? Let's take this example that we had. So we had the NPV of both investments, and we had the formula for the equivalent annual annuity. Again, remember the parentheses. So we can simply do it this time. We have a cost of capital of 8%. So we take for A, for example, we take 11.38. And then we should divide this by a big parenthesis, 1 divided by the interest rate, 0.08, times 1 minus 1 divided by 1 plus interest rate, 0.08, to the power of this n here is the life span of the project. So for A, this is 5 years. Take it to the power of 5. And then we close the parentheses. And for B, we can do the same thing. We take the NPV of 12.38. And we divide it by 1 divided by 0.08 times 1 minus 1 divided by 1 plus 0.08. And now this n should be the number of years it exists, which in this case is 7. And we close the parentheses. So the only difference here is in fact the 5 here and the 7 here. And that corresponds then to the different lifespans. So we compute something where the only difference in the computation is how long the investment keep going. And if we do this, we find that the equivalent annual annuity of A is 2.85, while that of B is only 2.38. And it means that equivalent annual annuity, remember that it corresponded to an, well, like it says, it's an equivalent annual annuity. So you take the NPV and you find an annuity that is a cash flow every year which of the same size, which is equivalent in present value to this NPV. So what this says is that instead of receiving an NPV of 11.38, we would be equally happy to receive 2.85 every year for 5 years then. And for B, instead of receiving an NPV of 12.38, we will be equally happy to receive 2.38 each year. Well, since we said that A could be repeated, it means that we can do this one more time, or many more times. So we could get this 2.85 every year for a longer period. And then we have suddenly converted it to something which can be compared, although they have different length. Because A would give us 2.85 every year, and B would give us 2.38 every year, or something that which is equivalent to that. And therefore, A is the better investment. So, the general investment decision rule for the equivalent annual annuity is just like the NPV. If the equivalent annual annuity is greater than zero, then you should invest. If it's not greater than zero, if it's negative, you should not invest. And if you have two mutually exclusive investments, which can be repeated, then, or replaced at equal terms, then we should choose the one with the highest equivalent annual annuity. So now we can suddenly compare investment with different lifespans when they can be repeated. Okay, it has many names. Sometimes it's called equivalent annual benefit or equivalent annual cost. They all refer to the same technique of how you do it. But it could be good to know if you encounter it some other time. Okay, so remember, an annuity is a regular constant cash flow for a fixed number of periods, like this. So what we did now was that we took the NPV here, and then we converted it to cash flows that are of equal size every year, which has a present value corresponding to this NPV. So it's a way of taking the NPV and making it into instead annual positive cash flows, if it's a positive NPV then. And therefore we could compare them when they had different lifespans. Okay, so as I said earlier, if we find the EIA, the equivalent annual annuity, getting that sum every year for the rest of the life or for the entire life of the investment would make us equally happy to receiving the NPV today. And that is why we can compare them different investments. So, advantages of the equivalent annual annuity: it accounts for the time value of money. It accounts for the risk of the project because it has an interest rate. It accounts for all cash flows caused by the project. It enables us to rank investments of unequal length if they can be replaced. But you need to remember that if we have to choose between two mutually exclusive investments, and they have unequal lifespans, but you cannot repeat them or you cannot replace them in any way with a positive NPV, then you should not look at equivalent annual annuity. In that case, then NPV is the decision criteria you should use. So let's say that you have a once in a lifetime opportunity. You can only choose this one or that investment. Then there's no replacement, so there's no need to think of what happens after this point. You should take the one with the highest NPV. Okay, so let's take a final example then. Here, A and B are mutually exclusive and they can be repeated. Which investment is the better one? And you can see we have an initial investment of 150 for A, 100 of B. We have a net annual cash flow of 40 for A and of 35 for B. So this means 40 every year for 5 years, and this means 35 every year for 4 years. We can also see that A has an end value, a salvage value of 20. So in the fifth year, we can sell on maybe this machine and receive 20. And we have a cost of capital of 10%. Okay, so what do we need to do? Well, we first need to compute the net present value of both. So we start with A. So the net present value of A is then equal to minus 150 plus 40. And since this is a net annual cash flow, we can use what we learned in time value of money. If we take this times 1 divided by the interest rate, which is apparently 10%, times 1 minus 1 divided by 1 plus 0.10 to the power of 5, because it's 5 years. And then we also need to add the salvage value here, which is in the last year. So we add plus 20 times 1 divided by 1 plus 0.10 to the power of 5. So if we would draw this in a timeline, A would cost 150 today. Sorry. 150 today. We would get 40 every year for 5 years. So here it says 40 on all. And then in the last year, we would accept for this 40. We would also get an extra income of 20. This was very sloppy writing. There we go. Okay, if we compute this net present value, we find that it's 14.05. We can make the similar thing for B. So the NPV of B would then be minus 100 plus, so this is the initial investment. The annual cash flow here is 35 times 1 divided by 0.10 times 1 minus 1 divided by 1 plus 0.10. And now we have 4 years, so we take it to the power of 4. And we find that this NPV is equal to 10.95. What we should do now is to take this NPV and divide it by this to get the equivalent annual annuity. And I already showed you how to do that, so you can take it as a practice at home. And you find that the equivalent annual annuity of A is 3.71, and the equivalent annual annuity of B is 3.45. So which investment should we then choose if we assume that this can be repeated? Well, we should focus on the highest equivalent annual annuity, and A has 3.71, B has 3.45. So here, A is clearly the better investment. And that was also what NPV would have told us, but that's not always the case. In this case, they agreed, but it doesn't have to be like that. Okay, so we have looked at NPV, and NPV is always like the benchmark that we measure all methods to, where you calculate the present value of all future cash flows, and the investment is profitable if NPV is greater than zero. Today, we looked at the equivalent annual annuity, where you take the NPV and you convert it to an equivalent annual annuity. And then you have like a yearly surplus, which you can compare between investments. And for a single investment, it's profitable if the equivalent annual annuity is greater than zero. If you compare mutually exclusive investments that can be repeated, you take the one with the highest equivalent annual annuity. Okay, so that's it for this video. Thank you very much.